As we begin this solemn ritual of Episcopal ordination, I ask you please to be seated just for a moment. It's a pleasure for me to welcome all of you to this Basilica of the National Shrine of the Immaculate Conception for the Episcopal ordination of Michael Fisher as Auxiliary Bishop of Washington. And as we begin these recognitions, I want to say that it's a great honor for all of us to have here present with us our Holy Father's personal representative and the Apostolic Nuncio to the United States, Archbishop Christophe Pierre. Thank you. I would also like to welcome back to the Archdiocese one of the co-consecrators, Bishop Barry Nestout, Bishop of Richmond. It's wonderful to have you back, Bishop. I'm not going to mention every bishop here because we do want to get on to the ceremony, but I do want to recognize the auxiliary bishops of Washington, beginning with our retired Bishop, Bishop Gonzalez, also Bishop Campbell, and I believe Bishop Dorsonville, who is also one of the co-consecrators. To all of you, thank you for your presence. To the bishops who have joined us, thank you for joining us and adding to the solemnity of this ceremony. To my brother priests, and you can see the huge, huge gathering of priests from across this archdiocese and from other parts of the country. Thank you for your presence, which adds a deep solemnity to what we're about to do. I also want to recognize the deacons here, the women and men in consecrated life, our seminarians who are here in very, very large number, and most particularly, all of the knights that are here, Knights of Columbus, Knights and Ladies of the Holy Sepulchre and St. Peter Claver and St. John, Knights and Dames of Malta, Knights of St. Gregory the Great. To distinguished guests, representatives of civil government, to our ecumenical and interfaith representatives, you honor us by your presence here today, but in a very, very special way, the family of Bishop-elect Michael Fisher. To all of you who are gathered here, and for those of you who are joining us on Catholic TV, my brothers and sisters, welcome to this Episcopal consecration. Let us now stand, and let us begin as we wish to begin all things. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Christ have mercy. Let us pray. O God, who on the solemnity of the apostles Peter and Paul, give us the noble and holy joy of this day. Grant, we pray, that your church may in all things follow the teaching of those through whom she received the beginning of right religion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring glad tidings to the lowly, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to announce a year of favor from the Lord and a day of vindication by our God, to comfort all who mourn, to place on those who mourn in Zion a diadem instead of ashes, to give them oil of gladness in place of mourning, a glorious mantle instead of a listless spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. may not blush with shame.
Lectura de la segunda carta del apóstol San Pablo a Timoteo. Querido hermano, ha llegado para mí la hora del sacrificio y se acerca el momento de mi partida. He luchado bien el combate, he corrido hasta la meta, he perseverado en la fe. Ahora solo espero la corona merecida con la que el Señor, justo juez, me premiará en aquel día. Y no solamente a mí, sino a todos aquellos que esperan con amor su glorioso advenimiento. Cuando todos me abandonaron, el Señor estuvo a mi lado y me dio fuerzas para que, por mi medio, se proclamara claramente el mensaje de salvación y lo oyeran todos los paganos. Y fui librado de las fauces del león. El Señor me seguirá librando de todos los peligros y me llevará sano y salvo a su reino celestial. Palabra de Dios.
The Lord be with you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. After Jesus had revealed himself to his disciples and eaten breakfast with them, he said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" Simon Peter answered him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." He then said to Simon Peter a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Simon Peter answered him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was distressed that he had said to him a third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise.
Your Eminence, the Holy Catholic Church, our Mother, asks you to ordain this priest, Reverend Monsignor Michael William Fisher, to the office of bishop.
Have you a mandate from the Apostolic See?
We have.
Let it be read.
Your Eminence, Cardinal Wuerl, Your Excellencies, Bishops d'Ansonville, Campbell, and Gonzalez, my brother Archbishop and Bishops, dear priests, deacons, consecrated religious and lay faithful of the Archdiocese of Washington, I am truly pleased to be with you this afternoon as Monsignor Michael Fisher. I'm quite happy to realize that things have not changed since the time of Jesus. Jesus keeps calling fishers. He will be ordained to the fullness of the priesthood and begins his ministry as auxiliary bishop, as a close and trustworthy co-worker of Cardinal Wuerl. Monsignor Fisher, I know that you and your family have roots across Maryland and Washington, D.C. I understand that you love baseball, so I was told, and are a lifelong Baltimore Orioles fan, but that you will defer respectfully to the Washington Nationals. As long as they are competing with the O's, we publicly express our confidence that drawing upon your almost 30 years of varied priestly pastoral experience in the Archdiocese of Washington, you will be a blessing for the clergy and faithful of this beloved local church, and even for the community beyond. May our Blessed Mother, in whose house we celebrate this sacred liturgy, protect you. And may the Apostles Peter and Paul, whose solemnity we celebrate today, encourage and sustain you in your episcopal ministry. And now I will read for you the apostolic letter of appointment. As you know, this letter is being sent and signed by the Holy Father in Latin. Unless you want me to read in Latin, I could. I prefer to read it in a very nice English translation. This is a letter. Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God, to our beloved son, Michael William Fisher, from the clergy of the Metropolitan See of Washington, and until now, Episcopal Vicar for Clergy there and Secretary for Ministerial Leadership, appointed auxiliary of the same see and at the same time elected titular Bishop of Toronto, greetings and apostolic blessing. Not long ago, our venerable brother, Donald William Cardinal of the Holy Roman Church Wuerl, Metropolitan Archbishop of Washington, requested another auxiliary bishop, owing to the pastoral needs of the church entrusted to him. Consequently, we, as supreme shepherd of the Lord's flock, judge that his request ought to be readily granted, since you, beloved son, are endowed with outstanding qualities of mind and heart, as well as local ecclesial experience, we judge that you are suitable for carrying out this office. Therefore, upon consultation with the Congregation for Bishops, by our supreme apostolic authority, we appoint you auxiliary of Washington, at the same time naming you titular Bishop of Toronto, together with all the rights and obligations which are connected to such a mission and to the episcopal dignity according to the norm of law. You may receive ordination from any Catholic bishop outside the city of Rome, the liturgical prescripts being observed. However, prior to this, in compliance with the sacred canons, you must make the profession of faith and take the oath of fidelity toward us and our successors. You did it. Very good. Finally, beloved son, join in fraternal communion with your venerable chief, shepherd, and the truly beloved Metropolitan Church of Washington. Be sure to fulfill the office being entrusted to you by making use especially of charity, the queen of all virtues, which never fails. Together with the intercession of our Immaculate Lady, we beseech for you the choicest gifts of the Paraclete Spirit. Given at Rome, at St. Peter's, on the 8th day of the month of June, in the year of the Lord, 2018, the 6th of our pontificate. And it is signed, Francis.
Dear brothers and sisters, at this point in the liturgy, the ritual of ordination calls for the bishop to address all of the faithful, laity, clergy, religious, and the bishop-elect himself on the duties of a bishop. And as I begin, it seems so appropriate, first of all, to recognize that the appointment of our new auxiliary bishop for this church is a grace that we have received from God and a blessing from our Holy Father, Pope Francis, to whom all of us here express our great appreciation. As we turn now to the ritual, I ask you, the faithful gathered here in this magnificent basilica, to reflect on what we're about to do. First, we must consider the position in the church to which our brother is being raised. Our Lord Jesus Christ was sent by the Father to redeem the human race. By his passion, death, and resurrection, Jesus won for us our salvation. And as he prepared to return to his Father in glory, he challenged all of us to be his witnesses. But he specifically sent the apostles into the world filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and they were to preach the gospel and gather every race and people into a single flock to be guided and governed in the way of holiness. How appropriate, as the Apostolic Nuncio has already mentioned, that today the Church Universal celebrates the solemnity of the two great leaders, St. Peter and St. Paul. Peter was called to head the apostles, that fledgling college of bishops. Paul, whom the Pope has so often referred to as the apostle of the new evangelization, carried the word to the Gentiles. The scriptures recount that he appointed two of his disciples as bishops, Timothy and Titus. What better day on which to celebrate the ordination of a new successor to the apostles? And because this apostolic ministry was going to continue to the very end of time, the apostles selected others to help them. And by the laying on of hands, which confers the sacrament of orders in its fullness, the apostles passed on the gift of the Holy Spirit, which they themselves had received from Christ. And in this way, by a succession of bishops unbroken from one generation to the next, the power is conferred at the very beginning of the church, were handed down, and the work of our Savior continues in our time. The third century Christian writer, Tertullian, very concisely expresses this in a very ancient tradition. The church from the apostles from Christ, and Christ from God. That's what we gather here today to confirm and renew. The ordination today has a very special meaning for the Church of Washington, because the bishop we ordain today comes as a son of this archdiocese, one who was formed in the faith here, served his entire priestly ministry here among us, and who brings a sense of continuity with all of the challenges of pastoral ministry today. In our time, the church also recognizes this very special moment. She faces the challenges of a new culture, the hegemony of secularism, and is thus called to be the witness of the new evangelization. Bishop Fisher's closeness to the priests of this local church in all of their ministries, whether in parishes or in the great variety of special ministries, has allowed him an opportunity to draw near to the living mission and ministry of this church. Speaking to priests in his homily at the Chrism Mass this year, Pope Francis said, "Closeness, dear brothers, is crucial for an evangelizer because it is the key attitude of the gospel. The Lord uses it to describe his kingdom." Pope Francis, in this unique moment of time and in his providential role as Supreme Shepherd of the Church Universal, offers us not only words of encouragement, but an example of living the joy of the gospel and experiencing the joy of the love of God's people. It is precisely in his outreach, his accompaniment, and his challenge to us to do the same that we find the response to the secularism that permeates our culture today. Now, as we return once again to the words of the ritual, we're reminded that because Bishop Fisher comes to his ministry and is anointed in the Holy Spirit, he does so precisely to stand in the midst of the church as an icon of Christ. And we, the ritual says, gladly and gratefully welcome our brother, whom we, the bishops, now admit into our college by the laying on of hands. And the faithful are called to revere him as a minister of Christ and a steward of the mysteries of God. How is it that a man can take on this enormous responsibility? How is it that he can find the wisdom and courage to stand in the midst of the church as the one who is to teach, to lead, and to sanctify? The first reading, taken from the book of the prophet Isaiah, confirms how this is going to happen. We are told that the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me and he has sent me. Words chosen specifically for this liturgy because they speak to your ministry and ordination, Bishop Fisher. It is the Spirit that has consecrated you and charged you to bring the good news to the afflicted, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives, and to announce a year of favor from the Lord. The anointing with chrism and the imposition of hands in this sacred ritual are not only visible signs to all of the faithful gathered here of your consecration, they're the actual efficacious action by which the Holy Spirit is truly poured out in a transforming and energizing manner. In the second reading, chosen again for this liturgy, taken from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy, we're reminded that you, Bishop Fisher, will have the same consolation as St. Paul wrote. The Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the proclamation of the gospel might be completed. Bishop-elect Fisher, before you responded to any other call from Christ or his church, you made a previous answer in faith. With Peter, you, together with all of us, responded to Jesus when he said, "Who do you say I am?" You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. It's in this context that Jesus goes on today to say to Peter and to you and to all of us, everyone in ministry, do you love me? It's not a question of faith, but a response and request for commitment. Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter's response is echoed in the hearts of every priest, every bishop here, and certainly in your heart. Peter said directly and clearly, "Lord, you know that I love you. Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." And all that Jesus said in return, and what brings us here, and what the church has attempted to do for 20 centuries, and what is at the very heart of priesthood, episcopacy, and why we're gathered here, Jesus simply said, "Feed my sheep." Soon you'll be anointed with sacred chrism, the oil of mystical consecration that is intended to bring forth an abundance of spiritual blessings. May it always be for you, as you exercise your episcopal ministry and stand in the midst of the faithful, an oil of gladness. May it always renew in you a spirit of joyful hope. May you show that joy of ministry that clearly radiates from the face of Pope Francis, who appointed you here. He tells us in both the joy of the gospel and the joy of love, ours is to be a ministry of mercy, compassion, forgiveness, and above all, God's love, made manifest through you in the world in which we live. In a few moments, the open book of the Gospels will be placed over your head. As an apostolic teacher, the bishop is to preach the word, be urgent, in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, exhort, be unfailing in prudence, patience, and all teaching. Your first responsibility is that of a teacher. When asked, "How do you bring this extraordinary saving message of Jesus into the world? How do you bring it into our culture, our time, into this secular environment?" Holy Mother Church asks that you respond, teach, 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 bear witness, bear witness, bear witness. Then you'll receive a copy of a sign of the office of bishop. You'll receive a ring that reflects as a copy that ring of the Second Vatican Council. Tradition tells us that the bishop's ring manifests visibly that he's pledged in love to the particular church entrusted to his care. You're to wear that ring as a sign of fidelity to this holy church. Another insignia of your office that you will receive today is the pastoral staff, the crozier. It's a symbol of your responsibility to keep watch over the whole flock so that someday, when our waiting in joyful hope is complete, you'll be able to present to Christ himself that portion of the flock that journeyed with you. And following your anointing will be an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And your investiture with the signs and symbols of the office. After all of that, you will simply stand in the midst of this community as an image and a likeness of Christ. In the light of this understanding of who you are and what is going on right now, our faith prompts us to very great joy as you are ordained a bishop of God's Holy Church, and I join my voice to that of your family, your friends, the presbyterate, and all the faithful of this local church in praise to God for this wonderful moment that promises so much good for this holy church. May God bring to fruitful completion what today he has so wondrously begun in you. The ancient rule of the Holy Fathers ordains that a bishop-elect is to be questioned in the presence of the people on his resolve to uphold the faith and to discharge his duty. And so, dear brother, do you resolve by the grace of the Holy Spirit to discharge until death the office entrusted to you by the apostles, which we are about to pass on to you by the laying on of hands?
I do.
Do you resolve to preach the gospel of Christ with constancy and fidelity?
I do.
Do you resolve to guard the deposit of faith entire and incorrupt as handed down by the apostles and preserved in the church everywhere and at all times?
I do.
Do you resolve to build up the body of Christ, his church, and to remain in the unity of that body together with the order of bishops under the authority of the successor of St. Peter the Apostle?
I do.
Do you resolve to render obedience faithfully to the successor of the blessed Apostle Peter?
I do.
Do you resolve to guide the holy people of God in the way of salvation as a devoted father and sustain them with the help of your fellow ministers, the priests and deacons?
I do.
Do you resolve, for the sake of the Lord's name, to be welcoming and merciful to the poor, to strangers, and to all who are in need?
I do.
Do you resolve to be a good shepherd, to seek out the sheep who stray, and to gather them into the Lord's flock?
I do.
Do you resolve to pray without ceasing to Almighty God for the holy people, and to carry out the office of high priest without reproach?
I do, with the help of God.
May God, who has begun this good work in you, bring it to fulfillment.
Please stand.
Dearly beloved, let us pray that the kindness of Almighty God in providing for the welfare of the church will grant an abundance of his grace to this chosen one.
Please kneel.
Lord, have mercy.
God,
Lord, be merciful.
Graciously hear our petitions, O Lord, and pour out upon this your servant the power of your blessing flowing from the horn of priestly grace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Please stand.
Thank you. God. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all consolation, who dwell on high and look upon the lowly, who know all things before they come to be, and who laid down observances in your church through the word of your grace, who from the beginning foreordained a nation of the just, born of Abraham, who established rulers and priests, and did not leave your sanctuary without ministers, and who from the foundation of the world were pleased to be glorified in those you have chosen. Pour out now upon this chosen one that power which is from you, the governing Spirit, whom you gave to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, the Spirit whom you bestowed upon the holy apostles who established the church in each place as your sanctuary for the glory and unceasing praise of your name. Grant, O Father, knower of all hearts, that this your servant, whom you have chosen for the office of bishop, may shepherd your holy flock. Serving you night and day, may he fulfill before you without reproach the ministry of the high priesthood, so that always gaining your favor, he may offer up the gifts of your holy church. Grant that by the power of the Spirit of the high priesthood, he may have the power to forgive sins according to your command, assign offices according to your decree, and loose every bond according to the power given to you by the apostles. May he please you by his meekness and purity of heart, presenting a fragrant offering to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom glory and power and honor are yours with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
May God, who made you a sharer of the high priesthood of Christ himself, pour out upon you the oil of mystical anointing and make you fruitful with an abundance of spiritual blessing.
Thank you.
receive the gospel, and preach the word of God with all patience and sound teaching. Receive this ring, the seal of fidelity adorned with undefiled faith. Preserve unblemished the bride of God, the Holy Church. Receive the mitre, and may the splendor of holiness shine forth in you so that when the chief shepherd appears, you may deserve to receive from him an unfailing crown of glory. Receive the crozier, the sign of your pastoral office, and keep watch over the whole flock in which the Holy Spirit has placed you as bishop to govern the Church of God. Let us stand and let us profess our faith. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, incarnate of the Virgin Mary, he became man. For our sake, he was crucified and was Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day,
in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all.
May the prayer of the apostles, O Lord, accompany the sacrificial gift that we present to your name for consecration, and may their intercession make us devoted to you in celebration of the sacrifice. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by your providence, the blessed apostles Peter and Paul bring us joy. Peter, foremost in confessing the faith, Paul, its outstanding preacher, Peter, who established the early church from the remnant of Israel, Paul, master and teacher of the Gentiles that you call. And so each in a different way gathered together the one family of Christ, and revered together throughout the world, they share one martyr's crown. And therefore, with all the angels and saints, we praise you as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you, firstly, for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, where they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, in paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord, Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for your servant Michael, whom you have been pleased to raise to the order of bishop. And in your mercy, keep safe your gifts in him so that what he has received by divine commission, he may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon this offering with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants who thought sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not winning our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Christ, can you say?
Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, who have been renewed by this sacrament, so to live in the church, the persevering in the breaking of the bread and in the teaching of the apostles, we may be one heart and one soul, made steadfast in your love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Father,
Please be seated.
Wow. Since a young age, my grandmother and my parents would bring me here to the shrine just to take in our faith. My mother graduated from high school just below us in the crypt church, so it is a very precious moment for me to be ordained a bishop here in this magnificent church, this house of Our Lady. You know, one of the things I used to dream about was that I could be an angel and fly up to these domes. Well, I think this is as close I'm ever going to get. Pope Francis shared with us not long ago, he said, "Put on Christ in your life and you will find a friend in whom you can always trust. Put on Christ and you will see the wings of hope spreading and letting you journey with joy towards the future. Put on Christ and your life will be full of his love. It will be a fruitful life." Every day I am amazed at this magnificent journey of life that I know is leading us to something amazing, that ultimate and extraordinary redemption that our Lord Jesus has brought into our world and into our lives. Our Lord who came to be one of us, to take us to himself. Our Lord now asks me to be a bishop. He continually fills my heart with many blessings as I try to follow his call as best as I can to serve him and his good people. Archbishop Pierre, again, I thank you for your presence here and the wonderful ministry as Apostolic Nuncio to the United States. You reflect and bring to us that special relationship and closeness to our Holy Father, to our local church here in the Archdiocese of Washington. I ask you to please share with our Holy Father my deepest appreciation and gratitude for the confidence that he has placed in me with this appointment as Auxiliary Bishop of Washington. I offer him my faithfulness, my love, and continued prayers for him as he shepherds the people of God. Your Eminence, Cardinal Wuerl, thank you for your kindness, your encouragement, and your confidence in allowing me to assist you in your awesome responsibility as shepherd to the people in this most vibrant and diverse archdiocese. It has been my home, and what a magnificent diocese it is. I've experienced it from Southern Maryland to Montgomery County into the city, in the many parishes where I live now, St. Mark's in Hyattsville, has more than 42 different cultures there. What an incredible place to celebrate ministry. I have been privileged to work closely with you these past 12 years as your vicar for clergy. Your zeal, your care, your commitment to be to the clergy, to our religious and our laity of this archdiocese have been an inspiration and example to me in my work. It has challenged me, and it has helped me see that we should give our untiring time to building this kingdom of God. I truly look forward again to deepening that bond now that I have with you as bishop, and I try my best to assist you in your responsibilities. Special thanks to the co-consecrating bishops. Bishop Nestout, I'm glad you made it through traffic. Bishop and I have been friends since the seminary. He was the first seminarian I ever met. And I have to say, it was because of his example that I really made that decision to go to the Mount, go Mounties, and to enter the seminary. I mean, we had magnificent seminaries. Seminarians, never lose heart, keep focused on the Lord, and you'll get there. Again, I thank Bishop Dorsonville, my brother, who we've worked so closely on so many things now with our brother priests. I look forward to deepening again that work. And Bishop Campbell, my brother, we have worked on a lot of things since your ordination, and you as a pastor, you give me inspiration in my work. I again, to all the bishops who are here this day, I thank you for taking the time to be here, to be with me, and to welcome me. I've been getting so many wonderful letters and cards of welcome into this wonderful College of Bishops. I look forward to meeting them and working closely with them. I have to highlight Monsignor Brennan. I'm sorry, not Monsignor. Bishop Brennan was actually my vocation director in the seminary. So thank you for being here with us. To my dear brother priest, what can I say? My words fail as I try to express my affection for all of you. What an incredible bond we have as Christ's priests. My responsibility as vicar for clergy has given me the ability to experience and observe firsthand the zeal for souls and the many sacrifices each one of these men live out in their daily lives, in their ministry to the people of their parishes. How many good priests are now with the Lord who have encouraged us? And as Monsignor Ewalt, one of my mentors, once said, we stand on the shoulders of these wonderful priests. I think of Monsignor Ewalt. I think of Monsignor D. Monsignor Cain is still among the living and with us. Father Roach taught me in the seminary. They're just wonderful examples of priestly ministry and being Christ to others. You are always in my heart and in my prayers. And when I use my crozier, it will remind me once again of our bond and friendship. To our brother deacons and seminarians and those in religious and consecrated life who I've had also the opportunity to work very closely with, you're an inspiration to our ministry in your call, in your commitment to your call to follow Christ. May you continue in your vocation and offering those great gifts to our church. I welcome and thank the many parishioners who have attended from the various parishes I have served. Again, especially St. Mark, where I have lived for almost 14 years. It's only two blocks from where I lived with my grandmother, so I really haven't gone too far from home. Again, what an example of the universal church that we have there at the parish. Thank you for helping me to appreciate the many cultures of our church here in Washington. St. John Neumann Parish in Gaithersburg, Holy Family in Hillcrest Heights, and I see lots of people from Sacred Heart, where I was a baby priest. Now I'm a baby bishop. I was a baby priest there. God bless you for helping me learn to be a good priest and to walk with you in your journey with Christ. I thank my many friends and, again, my family who have taken time out of their busy lives today to be here on this occasion. This is a precious moment for me, for you to be here and to share this with me. My brothers and sisters, my sister Kathy, who's come from Texas, Patrick, my brother, William Scott, my brother, my sister Terry's not here, but we're here together as family. And again, I thank all of you who have come so far to be with us. Finally, I remember my parents, Margot and Bill, now resting with the Lord. They gave me life, love, and sacrificed all for our well-being. Both instilled their love for God in each one of us through their silent witness and hard work. May eternal rest continue to shine upon them. And I can't end without mentioning my grandmother, who I lived with for many years. She who prayed many prayers that I would be a priest, said, "Oh, Grandma, I don't think you know what you're talking about." Well, I think she did. On this feast of St. Peter and Paul, I now ask for their special blessing and intercession as I embrace this awesome responsibility as a bishop. May I learn from their example of holiness and faithfulness to Christ's church. As His Eminence shared with us this morning to the seminarians, this every ordination is a renewal of the church. And this is a renewal for me as I begin my ministry as bishop. In this Basilica of the Immaculate Conception, I finally beg Our Lady's continued prayers for me as her son's priest, and in a special way to the intercession of Our Lady of Guadalupe, in whom she may give me a heart with a great zeal for souls. May her mantle of love and maternal presence be with me as I endeavor to be a good fisherman. As I end these remarks, please pray for me. As you know, I will always pray for you. I look forward to greeting each one of you after this celebration in the lower church for a nice reception. Again, thank you, Christ, Redeemer of all. Pray for us, St. Peter and St. Paul.
Bishop Fisher, I think that spontaneous and heartfelt expression of applause says how much you mean to all of us, to the priests for whom you have given so much time, energy, care, and love, and for everyone in this church who has benefited and will continue to benefit now in an even fuller and richer way. May this applause that you've received continue to ring in your ears and in your heart as you now move into this wondrous ministry that is the ministry of a bishop. Now let us ask God's blessing. The Lord be with you.
Bow down for the blessing.
May Almighty God bless you, for He has made you steadfast in St. Peter's saving confession, and through it has set you on the solid rock of the church's faith.
Amen.
And having instructed you by the tireless preaching of St. Paul, may God teach you constancy by His example to win brothers and sisters for Christ.
Amen.
So that by the keys of St. Peter and the words of St. Paul, and by the support of their intercession, God may bring us happily to that homeland that Peter attained on a cross and Paul by the blade of a sword.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.